comes out here. That's the effect. And now that's the visual thing. It's more psychedelic thing.
It's about falling. It's about falling.
It's an inch of power.
It's a movement.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I picked this one out because I thought common fate, you know, both literally and metaphorically. All these curves are coming out like this. And of course, they look like they're going down to somewhere not very nice. But I think that a lot of these pictures work for a lot of these simple sorts of reasons, because we can really draw a line. We can split the painting into this illustration, into this part, and above. And there are different things going on.
Well, the darkness at the bottom and the light at the top and the convergence of the bodies, upside down, upwards, and the actual shape at the top, the whole thing makes a very strong emphasis on the figure at the top.
Mm-hmm. It's very much a construction, so we know that it's not real, whereas the previous ones it was clear that it was an observation of a person.
There's an element of the netted cube and the bars in there. You see it, you can see it's like two pictures. It's quite hard to see them going together. Which we're saying it's not stable, or two halves don't go together, you have to look at the top and the bottom.
You can't see it at the bottom, you have to look at the top or the bottom to see it's two separate. You
can draw it together,
but it's cheap. You have to flip and then
So it's painting that sort of pulls itself apart. So maybe that's being easier then. Okay, what do we have to say about this?
It's a very good picture.
So we've got a bunch of curves basically, haven't we?
Just
a dancing or running or striding figure.
A little bit more like this sort of like haughtiness or something like that, like the face and the movement suggests character in the person.
So, one of the things I noticed about this is the hem of the dress seems to go, it's actually disconnected, but you read it. And it also seems to continue out to the back. It sort of groups itself. And there's a body there, but we read it, don't we? And these lines give a sense of a twist. And these in the hat give you a sense of the shape of the hat. So we're reading the sort of flow, the continuity of it a lot.
Whereas you identify those with the continuity and the shape of it.
Yes.
The lines at the bottom that go in this kind of direction, yeah, you identify as speed and movement, as opposed to a twist or a 3D visualization.
Yeah.
You identify the diagonal lines as she's going somewhere or moving rapidly, or even the slight kind of cloud shape behind you, that she's like being visible.
You could take them out and the figure was still exist. It's not really clear what they are. And that might be a sort of set of another shape or something like that.
Yeah.
But that sort of set of curves behind doesn't seem to mean anything.
I have haven't worked that out yet.
It helped me to see as I'm looking down. But without that, I might have been looking straight on.
But then you've got the lines of the floorboard and whatever to draw to save the movement.
It was clearly a problem that you might not be able to so put some floorboards in. I think that was a failure on this part. There's too many lines on the floorboards compared with the fact that with about four lines you could produce a whole grid. Skill of a cartoonist. You know, I don't think somebody who's giving instructions for doing wall covering, so you more recently a cartoon.
Well, you can't put it without cartoon.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good time to move on. This is Picasso, and
reminds me of the quote by Picasso, when he was building style. It will be, you'll grow into it.
any observations about this?
That one with the shared business support, isn't it?
It may or may not be.
It has an element of the same hue in that the hands seem to be quite important. And the eyes, important to the eyes as well, the glasses in there. So there's three perspective art in it as well.
I think it says that he drew a face and hands first, and then put the rest of it round, and they didn't quite fit the mind.
There's something that I noticed after a while. If you look at the cloth and the wood, something that is not skin, you'll see that there are no isolated little marks. They're all big, they're all connected up, and they tend to be quite long. Or they're little circles. They nearly always connect up. But if you look at the hands and the head, there are little sort of wrinkly lines, little shading lines, or, you know, they could be wrinkles, they could be hairs. There's something pretty horrible up the nose. Right, so that strikes me as quite a clever choice. It's choosing which details, selecting which features, and how to represent them. And there's a kind of code here, which you can think of as an aesthetic, which to me, just this aspect of these little lines, that's being used as an aesthetic. Because to me, everything looked flat, apart from the skin, and I was talking about why. And it's because there aren't any of these lines on the rest of it.
Don't seem expected.
Don't
seem
the chair is feeding into it. Yeah, but it still is a very flattened way of looking. You know, it's like screen print, so it can look very flat. It's still a flat look to it, even though it is a dimension. It could be made out of cards, these sort of greetings cards where you open it up and bits pop out. You know, like the kitten or something pops up out of the card.
I know it sounds sacrilege, but for me, the top half of the beta contains, the top half of the drawing contains everything. But from the hands down, really seems to just... it doesn't really make sense in itself. From the hands up, it's very clear what it is. It's a half a man with his hands crossed. But from the bottom half of the beta, it's just... you seem to lose the... If you just look at the bottom half of the photo, you don't group it into anything meaningful. The picture, you don't group it into anything meaningful. The top half is where all the...
It's very hard to read the bottom half by itself.
Yeah, it doesn't... You don't understand what it is.
Well, you can understand it if you don't look at it. And you just see it one half the body.
Yeah.
So it's a kind of a trick, isn't it? I'm leaving it all. And there are an awful lot of paintings where they do leave an awful lot of detail out, but they don't particularly want to look.
The light maybe is the next thing
to do. I was trying to work that out. Maybe
it's
a cross,
isn't it?
Yeah,
it's
really. But,
and nothing comes out, does it?
The right leg's fine, you know, it just looks like the right leg, but the bent of the knee, but yeah, there's some really funny things to do.
Yeah, so, right, that's about it. So I think, I'm sorry if this is a bit too predictable, but we had that broccoli thing where so we can have. Yes. Now, first of all, what do you see? What would you comment on here?
Mm-hmm. Looks a bit like claws.
Claws, yeah.
The similarity between that front wave and the front wave.
Oh, yeah. That was clever, wasn't it? Yes.
See the waves first and then the boats come along afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I did see the boats instead.
But one of the things that people like to use this sort of Hokusai image as is an example of fractals before they were invented. So, this was done around about 1830, and generally something with a similar mathematical construction of a fractal. I don't really know when they were sort of first in, but the early one I know about is sort of early 20th century. So maybe that was afterwards. But the idea is that you've got a big wave structure coming over, the whole thing. And then, on a lower scale, it's like the vegetable, you've got a part here coming over, and you've got some layers coming. So there's a layer, there's a layer. So this would be the second level. And then there's a third level with the individual groups, if you like, of four or five. You know, somebody said claws, so it's an actual hand. Little hands with three or four claws coming out. And then the claws themselves. They like to use this as an example of a fractal, where the wave is, if you like, a big claw. And then if you go down through a few different layers, three or four different layers of claws of different sizes. And again, this is the sort of thing that they like to do when they're making movies. And the clouds as well have this kind of property. There are big bumps, and then around big bumps there are little bumps. And so, they like this as a sort of idea of self-similarity coming into kind of visual language. So, well, this was around before the Gestalt, but I haven't seen it particularly.
It's taking this back home and showing this brush painting, particularly landscape painting.
Right.
They'll draw branches of trees using the exact approach, and that's where you go.
Yeah. I think there was some sort of influence, direct influence.